Hey, what's up everyone? This week, I want to talk to you about that kind of situation where we have a problem in our codebase. We try to solve it by introducing a clever trick, only to discover a few weeks later that maybe our trick was a little bit too clever for its own good, and we've just basically ended up hurting ourselves. And so let's take a look at a typical situation where we're going to be tempted to introduce some kind of automation. As you can see, I've written the code for a property that is stored inside the user default. And that property stores whether or not the user prefers the app to be in dark mode. And so both the getter and the setter of this property are implemented through the user defaults API. And as I'm sure you already know, whenever we want to set or retrieve a value in the user default, we need to provide a key, and that key acts as the identifier for the value being persisted. And as you can see in this small piece of code, this key takes the form of an hard-coded string that is present both in the getter and also in the setter. And of course, having that kind of hard-coded strings in our code is not great. And so it's only natural that we would like to automate this process, meaning that we would like to be able not to have to write these strings ourselves, but maybe have either the compiler or the runtime environment provide a value that makes sense in our place. And that's actually quite easy to achieve because there is a very easy way in Swift to get a string that contains the name of the property that you are implementing. And the way this is achieved is simply by using the special variable hashtag function. And this special variable will always contain the name of either the function or the property that is being implemented. So here in this example, hashtag function will contain the value prefers dark mode, which is exactly the value that we were using for our hard-coded string. So I'm going to use also hashtag function here. And now on the surface, at least, my code looks much cleaner because I'm no longer relying on magical hard-coded strings. And instead, the key that I use to interact with the user default is now generated automatically, and it is derived from the name of my property. But as I was saying in the introduction, even though this approach definitely is clever, it might be a bit too clever for its own good. And the reason why I'm saying this is because we've essentially linked together two different pieces of information. On the one hand, the name of a property in Swift code, and on the other hand, a key that is used to persist data on a user's device. And even though both these information are of the same type, meaning that they are both strings, they actually have very different characteristics. Because in Swift, the name of a property doesn't have to stay the same over time. Between each build of your app, you are totally free to change the name of any identifier in your code. And as long as you change that name everywhere, your app will still build and will still behave the same way. However, things are very different for the key that you use to persist data in the user default, because that value has to stay the same over several releases of your app. Because if you change that value in a new build, then that new build will not be able to access the value that was saved by a previous build of your app. And so you want the value of that key to be extremely stable over time, because if it changes, either you lose the data that was previously saved, or you have to write some explicit code to migrate your data to the new key. So now we understand why this approach is too clever for its own good. It's because if we were to refactor our code and just rename our property, so for instance, we rename it from prefers dark mode to prefers dark theme, by doing so, our app is now going to use a new key to read and write the value persisted to the user default. And so any already existing data that had been previously persisted using the old key would simply be ignored by the new build of our app. And of course, this is the total opposite of how we would like our app to behave in that kind of situation. So what should you take away from this video? My goal with this video was to show you that even though it's only natural for a programmer to want to automate and optimize any kind of boilerplate, we also need to be very careful about how we implement this automation. Otherwise, it might just end up creating more issues than it will have actually solved. And that's all for this video. As always, if you have other examples where an automation starts by looking like a good idea but ends up proving itself to be a terrible one, please share them with me in the comment. I would be super curious to know about them. Thank you for watching the video and see you next time.